Western.
This is our third financial report. We'll bring you a detailed look at how we've done and the reasons why.
Then Salt Lake will come into Western system, not as a city, but as an aircraft.
We're in the boom or bust town of Butte, Montana, one of Western's oldest locations.
You'll meet some of the people who pioneered this station and hear some tall tales.
And there's more.
I'm Leslie Kumamoto.
I'm Ken McConnell. Stay with us.
The mines are quiet here, just a few miles from the Continental Divide. But tourism and the natural beauty of this part of Western Montana keep us flying into Butte. On August 1, 1937, a merger took place between Western Air Express and National Parks Airways. With the consummation of this action, Western began service to Butte, Montana. The airport here is named after a flamboyant aviator who helped found National Parks Airways and later became one of Western's chief pilots, Burt Mooney. Burt died more than a decade ago, but he left his mark on flying. Ole Anixdal began working for Western in 1945, and he remembers Burt Mooney.
I like Burt Mooney, and he had his shop and stuff down at the old airport too, you know, and give private lessons to people and everything.
Mooney's widow still lives in Butte, and she told us about the early days of aviation.
I think it was fearsome. You were so afraid when you got in those little, you're right up in the cockpit, you know, with the pilot. And, nowadays it's just comfortable and a great pleasure to get on one of these big airliners. Now, to you folk, it doesn't mean anything. It's just part of getting up and going out and doing your job. But then it wasn't. You had to have something that he had, that it took.
Burt Mooney wasn't the only famous aviator to fly into Butte. Do you remember this guy? He's Charles Lindbergh with the Spirit of St. Louis, and they are coming out of a hangar that still exists today. June of 1983, Anaconda Copper suspends all mining operations here. So an industry that began back in 1864 fell silent. The Berkeley Open Pit Mines, which is slowly filling with water, is one of the legacies left after the shutdown. Remnants of the copper boom can be seen on every hillside. The memory of this glorious era is maintained at a World Museum of Mining, free to anyone who enters. For a short period, Butte's economy took a drastic downturn. But the people here are a hardy breed. And before long, new industries stepped in to take the place of King Copper. New business is popping up everywhere, and the community recognizes the importance of the tourist trade, which Western helps to provide. A once declining population is growing again, and employees at the Butte station believe in the community so much that they sponsored this float in the 4th of July parade.
It's not too far from big cities. You can get on a plane and go someplace with, you aren't really out in the boondocks. Good educational system here. There's a lot of nice people around here. They're friendly.
Butte is my town. I like it. It's a mile wide, a mile high, and a mile deep with a mile high smile.
I like Butte, and it's a lot of friendly people, and it's just a lot of fun to work here.
Once every 3 months, another financial quarter passes. And once every 3 months, we tell you how we've done. The second quarter has just ended, and we are pleased to report that our airline had an all-time record for any quarter in the company's history. In fact, the news is so good that it goes beyond breaking a record. We have actually more than doubled the earnings of any previous second quarter since our planes took to the skies in 1926. The facts really tell the story, though, so let's get right to them. The bottom line is that net income totaled $31.7 million through June 30th. In the second quarter of last year, Western lost $13.7 million. This is a $45 million turnaround. And as you'll hear later, this has drawn the attention of the financial community to us once again. The first 6 months of this year is a period of time in which we also set records. Our net income totaled $45 million, and this is an enormous about-face from this time period last year when we lost $36.7 million. This is an improvement of $81.7 million. Western has been able to maintain a yield, or average revenue per passenger mile, of about 11 cents for the year to date. In the second quarter, yield averaged about 11.31 cents, up from 11.05 cents last year. What this means is that we are bringing in more revenue for every mile a passenger travels this year than we did last year. When you combine this fact with a 21% increase in revenue passenger miles, you have a record for operating revenues. They totaled $357.9 million this year in the second quarter compared to $293.9 million last year at this time. The figures for our second quarter expenses include nearly $7 million, which was set aside for our profit-sharing plan. Another $1 million was paid out as a bonus, $100 to each employee. For the 6 months ending this past June 30th, we now have $9.5 million reserved for employee profit sharing. Profit sharing checks will be based on how we do for the year as a whole. And the word from Western financial people is that our outlook for the next two quarters is quite promising. There is every reason to be optimistic. Let's talk to one of our specialists. Our second quarter came in like gangbusters. Was that due totally to the United strike?
Of course, the United strike had an awful lot to do with it. But underlying it is a steady building of profitability ever since late last year. Essentially, we have structured this airline so that we're able to be profitable in a world of 11 cent yields. And yields actually came in at about 11.31 cents. So we would have definitely been profitable. But the real story is the buildup in cash, because, of course, making money translates directly to cash. We have built cash from December 31 of 1984, when we had a fully drawn $20 million credit line. We had cash sent about $57 million. We ended this quarter, June 30, 1985, with $166 million in cash. So that we're well over $100 million better off at the end of second quarter.
Some analysts say that our cost per seat mile is too high and that we won't survive the next downturn in the economy. How do you respond to that?
When faced with competition like that coming from Continental, that's something we've got to be very vigilant on. We're continuing to control costs tightly. It's something we really can't let up on, because in the long term, the long run, the low-cost carriers are the ones that are going to be the survivors. But we do have a very good cost structure in place. We are among the lowest in seat mile costs among the major carriers, and we expect that to go a long way towards meeting competition. We're making a lot of progress, and Wall Street is beginning to take notice. The New York Times had a feature article on us a few weeks ago talking about the Western turnaround. So it's really gratifying to see that.
Since the health services program began, some 800 employees have used it. Bill Callicott has this update on HSP today.
This is a meeting of the Health Services Program Master Steering Committee, jointly attended by the unions and management. The union reps you see here, along with the management people, meet once every 3 months to monitor the progress and development of the HSP program. Everyone here is free to offer their suggestions and to point out ways they think HSP can best live up to its commitments. They are to help Western improve its efficiency by improving overall employee health, while concurrently showing compassion and concern for all employees, represented or not. Since HSP came into being in 1984, about 800 Western employees have sought assistance through its services. And its services are varied and vital. The HSP is here to help, and anyone with a personal or medical problem can use this resource to get referrals to a physician, a psychologist, a counselor, or an outside group. In the next few weeks, HSP will be releasing a brand new television presentation called Well Enough, and it's a detailed look at the services this group offers us and the people in HSP that employees can contact if they need help.
You're going back to Salt Lake to join Flight Attendant Mary Ellen Moore. She's at the dedication of Aircraft 303. I'll take the next flight. ¶¶
What's all the music? What's all the food? Is that the mayor of Salt Lake City? Mr. Lee? Mr. Wilson? The press? And what's that mysterious silver aircraft? The commotion is all about aircraft 303, our latest 737-300. 303 is being dedicated to the city of Salt Lake to show our gratitude for the support its citizens have given to us. In fact, since we inaugurated air service here in 1926, the city has worked closely with us to keep our operations working smoothly. So not only were we the first carrier into Salt Lake, today we are also the largest, and we are still growing. It's a relationship that has lasted almost 60 years with a very bright future.
We're going to close our show from Butte.
This established Western station has a lot of attractions. We'd like to thank one of them.
The World Museum of Mining. Thanks for your hospitality.
And thank you for your suggestions. Keep them coming.
We'll see you next time.
So long.
Bye-bye.
Oh, they tell me our home, where my friends have gone.